There we go. Okay, great. I'm glad that I checked that. Okay. So, I like to start out my workshops like that because I think that it loosens everybody up, and if you get nothing else out of this presentation, at least you met somebody new and you got some exercise. So, hopefully you do get something out of this, and that's what we're going to talk about next, is what this workshop is all about. So, how many of you filled out the pre-event survey that I sent out? You're my heroes. Thank you for being so great. I realize that not everybody has a timer. Maybe you didn't get the link or something. There was a problem with the link, so I'm sorry about that. But from the survey that I, the responses that I got, it was pretty diverse in what you were hoping to get out of the workshop. Most of you seem to be kind of new to ES6, and so that's where I'm going to put most of my focus. A couple of you were like, yeah, let's get into generators and proxies, and I think that's awesome, and that would be a lot of fun, but each one of those subjects would take 2 hours by themselves, and so we're not going to get into that. So if that's what you're here for, I'm sorry. We don't have time to get into a demo of every single feature of ES6, so feel free to go elsewhere if that's what you're really hoping for. I will not be offended, just hurt. Just kidding. So I'm not an avid spec reader or TC39, like, you know, language writer or anything like that. I just have been using this for ES6 for a long time, and I love it. And yeah, this is going to be a very hands-on workshop. So I'm going to show you most of the features that you're likely to be using day to day. That does not include proxies or generators, really, to be perfectly honest. There are like subsets of scenarios where you'd actually use those things. I am somebody who's used ES6 since Babel was 6 to 5. Anybody in that same camp? Did anybody use 6 to 5 when it was 6 to 5? That was a long time ago in JavaScript lifetime, I guess, like a year and a half ago. So yeah, a long time ago. So yeah, I'm gonna just show. Well, so this workshop is actually a subset of a bigger workshop, and you can actually see a recording of that. The second half of the workshop is migrating an app from ES5 to ES6 using Webpack and making it so you can start writing ES6 and stuff. So if that's something that you want to do, migrate your app, then you can check out the other half of the workshop. And hopefully this is interactive, exciting, and fun for you. So the way that we're going to do things is we're going to learn a topic, an ES6 subject, and then we're going to code it individually, and then we'll repeat. So it should be fairly iterative, and the repo that you're installing is where you're going to be actually hands on the keyboard coding stuff. So here are the steps. If you didn't get those set up, yeah, you're going to need this, so go to kcd.im/, I can't remember what my short URL for these slides are. ES6 intro slides. Yeah. Yeah, so it's kcd.im/ES6 intro slides. So go to that URL so that you can follow these setup steps. Is anybody, or how many people are set up, all ready to go? Okay, most of you. If you are not set up and you need help, ask your neighbor. We're all friends here. You at least know one person because I made you. So, great. Oh, great. Yeah, so check Slack. Thank you. Great. Do we have a whole channel for this workshop? Oh, my goodness. I feel like that's a special thing. Okay, cool. So let's dive in. Actually, I wasn't really planning on giving any background on JavaScript, the language, and what ES6 even is. Does anybody want me to get into that background at all? Would that be useful, or do you want to just learn about the features? We do have a limited time, so... Sorry? Just learn the features? Okay. Okay. We're just going to jump into the features. ES6 is great, and it's an important part of JavaScript. Okay, that's all you're going to get from that. So I'm going to try and make this big enough for everybody to see even those of you in the back. The first thing that we're going to be talking about are let and const block scope binding constructs. So here we have this variable, or this function, we just call it f. And inside of here, we have a bunch of these curly braces that aren't actually associated with if statements or for loops or anything. You might not be familiar because, like, why would you ever do this? But you can actually create a block in JavaScript at any point in time, anywhere, just for the fun of it. Like I said, I have never actually done this in real code. But we're doing this to demonstrate how let and const work. So instead of... using the var keyword. Am I in your way? Sorry. Let me just like try and get out of my way there. Oh, and actually I was going to ask, do I need to use the microphone? Would this be helpful if I did that? Is that good?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay, great. I'm going to do that then. Wow, that is loud. Okay. So, yeah, instead of using the var keyword, we can use the let keyword, and that is for all intents and purposes, like mostly the same as var. There are a couple very big and important differences about how let and var behave. It's like, especially with respect to a block like this. So if I say, let's see, we'll put it inside the block. If I say var foo equals var, oops, except without the equals, there we go. Then in here I can say console.log foo, and I'm going to get var as my output there. Okay, but if I change that var to a let, then when I try to console.log foo, I'm going to get foo is not defined. And that is because let and const as well are block scoped. So this is actually kind of going back to the behavior in lots of other languages where variables are block scoped, scoped to the for loop that you're in or whatever. And so that kind of helps us avoid some of the problems with, especially with like for loops and stuff. It makes things a little bit more predictable. And so I actually pretty much never use var myself anymore. Yeah, let's see. There's also this... I'm not going to get too far into it, but you've probably heard of the oh shoot, now I can't even remember what the term is. It's the temporal dead zone. Maybe you've heard of the temporal dead zone, and that basically is the any code that exists before the declaration. So this is the temporal dead zone, and that basically means that you can't access x or foo, or this const x either, anywhere above where the declaration happens. That is not true with var. With var declarations, they get hoisted up to the top of the closure, effectively doing basically this, what we see here. And so that's another distinguishing characteristic of let and const. Is the fact that they're not actually, the declaration itself is not hoisted, and you wind up with this temporal dead zone thing, which like comes with trade-offs and stuff, but most of the time it's great, and so I prefer to use let and const for that. So there's, like, why do we have let and const? Why don't we just have let? So const has one additional thing that you can do, an additional semantic to it. And that is that you can't reassign variables that were declared with const. So if I say, you know, const x equals sneaky, and then I try to reassign x to foo, then I'm going to get a compilation error. So in this case, Babel will cry and say, hey, I can't transpile this. But like let and const are actually implemented in your browser right now. And so if you were to try to do the same thing, it would be a parser error that you would get in your browser. So not even a runtime error, your code won't even parse. And so that is another nice thing about const, and I actually prefer to use const. I use it pretty much everywhere. The reason for it is I think that code is easier to read when you're not reassigning variables everywhere. And so like I'll just create a new variable if I want to like make changes to something. One important thing to note about const that's like kind of people sometimes get confused about const, is it doesn't make the variable itself immutable. So if I say x is equal to an object, it is totally legit for me to say x.foo equals hi. So there's nothing about immutability. The only immutable thing here is the binding of x to what it's assigned to. That association is the immutable part. And that's pretty much it for let and const. Anybody have any questions before we get into exercises? All right, sweet. So let's go ahead and jump into our exercises together. So I got all set up. If we go, let me pop open my editor. Where did my editor go? There we go. Oops. How embarrassing. I just closed my editor after opening it. There we go. Okay, so actually, shoot, I totally forgot to check in the back. Can you see? You probably can't see my file names and stuff right here, can you? Yeah, okay, let me fix that really quick. I normally do this right before, and I really apologize for not doing it. But I've got this fancy stuff. This is one of the things I love about Atom, is that I can change things like magic. So, and using CSS and JavaScript and stuff. Okay, cool. So here, let me just introduce you to the project a little bit before we actually start coding stuff up. So here in our package.json, we have a couple scripts. How many people here have used NPM scripts before? Okay, so I'll just explain really quickly how NPM scripts work. Actually, I'm just going to pop open my little terminal Atom plugin here. So when you have a package.json in your directory, you can do npm run, npm run, and that will show you, you just run npm run, that will show you all of the scripts that you have available in the project. So here we have a lint script, and we have test watch and test final, so on and so forth. So what that means is I can say npm run, and then whatever these scripts are, so I could say lint, and it will run my lint script. And if we look in here, the lint script is running ESLint across exercises final and common. So that's kind of handy. So the script that we're going to be, and actually one of the benefits of this is not only does it like actually codify the scripts that are important in here, but also these scripts have access to locally installed binaries, like the Jest CLI. And so for us, we're going to be, and then there are a whole bunch of other features about this that I'm not going to get into, like this all this magic stuff. But the script we're going to be running is the test watch script. So if we run npm run test colon watch, which incidentally is actually what you run when you run npm start, so you, either one works. You're going to wind up, you'll probably wind up with a whole bunch of errors. This is because that's like your job is to fix these errors, and you haven't done your job yet. So let's do that. So to make things a little bit easier, we're going to change Jest. So actually, this is one of the coolest things. Jest is amazing and has this really awesome interactive watch mode. And so like in your terminal, you can interact with it and it's awesome. So we're going to change Jest watch mode to be the only changed watch mode, which basically says only run the tests for which files have changed since the last git commit. So I'll hit the O key, and then because you haven't made any changes yet, you're going to not run any tests. So from here, you can start going to the exercises folder and pop open the block scoping file and start making all these tests pass. And once you save the file, then Jest will recognize that and run those tests. So let's do that. Just do one together. So we'll say let band name equal, and if we see what the test is, we just need to make the test pass without changing your assertions. We'll say let band name equal queen. And also, let is best and equal true. When you save that and look at your terminal, then you're going to get that your tests reran and that overall they failed, but you have one passing test. and that is the one that we just changed. So you keep on doing this, you save the file, you let Jest rerun your tests, and once you have everything green, then you're going to see this nice thing that says passed at the top there. So any questions about how to get things going with Jest? Does anybody have is anyone having trouble getting it to run properly? Okay, then I'm going to give you probably 5 minutes. Feel free to raise your hand and ask me questions, or ask your neighbor questions, because we all have a friend here now. So I'm going to stop talking. Actually, I'm not. I have one other thing that I wanted. I just barely found out, which is super, super cool. So if you run npm run, well, just the same thing as we just ran, npm run test watch, and then we're going to forward on notify, then it's going to pop up a notification to us as soon as it's all done. Ah, rats. I thought it would. I saw this on Twitter just like seconds ago, and somebody had a notification pop up over here. Oh, I actually have Do Not Disturb turned on. There we go. So I'll try that again. Boom. 84% failed. Isn't that so cool? I love Jest. As of like 2 weeks ago, I started using it, and I just totally love it. Anyway. Anybody struggling? Yes. Oh, sure. Oh, you're fine. Yeah, it is npm run test watch. And if at any time you're, yeah, sorry, it's like the bottom of the screen. Here, I'll just put it up here. npm run test watch. There you go. And if at any time you're not sure what to, like what scripts you have available, you can look in the package.json, or you can simply run npm run, and it'll show you the scripts that are available. Oh, and actually, you can also, even more simply, I keep forgetting about this, but you can run npm start. That'll work as well. Anybody finished? Sweet. Yeah? Can you use Jest with tap? So you mean like writing your tests in tap, or using the tap CLI? Yes, writing the tests in tap, but then using Jest. So I'm not super familiar with tap. I haven't used it myself, but if you look at the tests, I'm pretty sure that they're fairly similar to tap, right? Like as far as the, you know, you have the test global that takes a name and a callback function. You have some assertions in there. The assertions are global variables that are coming from Jest, but you can actually use any assertion library that you like. So actually, last night when I migrated from Mocha to Jest, I actually, the initial migration was just changing the tooling and what binary I was using to run the tests, and everything just magically worked. And then I iteratively like migrated away from like Chai's expect assertions and stuff. So anyway, all that to say that Jest works just fine with any assertion that you want. You can use nodes assert if you wanted to. Does that answer your question?
Yeah,
Jest does support promise-based testing. We'll get into that. It also supports async await. So like, I guess that kind of makes sense, right? So yeah, and we're not going to get to async await, but if you want to jump ahead, that's the last one. So the task in that one is just rewrite these promise stuff in async await. So sweet. Anybody else finished with the tests? All right, awesome, looking good. I'm gonna give you just a minute minute more, and while we do that, I'm going to just cheat really quick and copy paste. Boom. Right, my tests are passing. Ha. Okay. Great. So if you want to, you don't have to do this, but if you want to, you can actually go ahead and commit your changes, and then Jest will like pretty much start over again for you, so you're not rerunning these tests for the next section. You don't have to do that, but we can say git commit all the things step one. You don't have to do that. It's not really necessary, but if you want to. Okay, sweet. Oops. All right, so the next thing that we're going to talk about is template literals. So how many people here have used template literals? Okay, fun. So actually, I should have asked in the beginning, how many people here are using ES6 at work right now? Okay, how many people here are using ES6 for fun right now? Everybody, because you just did it. Isn't that cool? So, yeah, okay. So template literals, handful of you have used these before. Their main utility is to be able to use them for interpolation. There are a couple other cool things about them, but I use them mostly for interpolation. So what do I mean by that? So back in the good old days, when we would want to concatenate strings together, we'd say const thing is equal to greeting plus a string with a comma and space and then noun. And that would work just as well, but that's not very pleasing to the eye. And so with template literals, you use a backtick. And then inside of here, you use the special syntax with the dollar curly brace to say, let me back up. So you've got this backtick. You're saying, hey, JavaScript, I'm in string mode now, so treat what I type as a string. And then when you use this dollar curly brace, you say, hey, string mode JavaScript, I'm in JavaScript mode now, so treat everything inside of here as JavaScript. And in here, we're just passing in greeting. So it says, okay, greeting to string. And then I close that off. So once you close your curly brace, you're like, okay, I'm back in string mode now again. And then everything else in there is just interpolated as a string. And then you go back to dollar curly brace. You say, okay, I'm in JavaScript mode now, and you can put anything in here that you like that is valid JavaScript, and it will two-string that for you. And then you say, hey, I'm back in string mode, and then you say, okay, I'm done being in string mode. That is basically the conversation you're having with JavaScript when you are using template literals or these backticks. So one of the kind of cool things about this is that when you're inside of the JavaScript mode, inside of a template literal, you can do anything that you want in here. You can call a function, you can like add things together, you can do anything that's valid JavaScript. You are literally in JavaScript mode right here. You can like do all kinds of really interesting things. So that's kind of a handy thing. I often try to avoid doing too many complicated things inside of my template literals just because I think that it can be a little confusing. So generally, if I want to do something complicated, I'll put that assign the value of that to a variable and then just interpolate that into my template string just because it makes a little bit more sense. I'm so cold. Okay, so let's see. Another cool thing that you can do with template literals is you can make multi-line strings. And so you start out with your template literal with a backtick, and then literally everything until the next backtick is part of the string. And so there's a new line character right there. That's part of the string. You have this string of HTML, and then another like more new line characters everywhere. That all works just fine. So we see the output here, multi-line has that new line character and all the new lines for the whole string. So that's kind of nice because the alternative is basically what Babel is transpiling this to, which is like, okay, a new line, and then all this. Yeah, not very fun. Yeah. Cool. Any questions about template literals? Yeah?
Is there a good way to remove excess indentation or like new lines at the
very end? Yeah, good question. So let's say that you were... Actually, we kind of have an example of this in the test, but like, if you wanted the final output to not have this indentation right here, for example. So there is not anything built into the language to do that, you can, like, there's a module on NPM called deindent that can like remove the indentation. And actually, that's kind of a segue into our tag. Stuff with some weird wizardry with template literals. So you can kind of call a function on a template literal, but it's a little bit special and unique. And there, I'm pretty sure the dindent module exposes this kind of a function to you, so you could just use that. But yeah, I have some really, like, this is a really contrived example of tagging strings, and I don't often use tagging template literals. So I'm not going to delve into this too far. And we actually have an example in the test, and I probably won't give you time to do that because we don't have a whole lot of time to begin with. And honestly, you probably won't be using this all that much. But just suffice it to say that here we have this function called translate. Basically, what we're doing is I made this contrived example to translate a string, like a template literal string. So you can actually change it from English to German by saying DE, and now it's Hallo, can't see dots. I don't know how to say German words, but it's, yeah, German stuff. But anyway, the way that you use this template literal tagging function is you just stick it right in front of the back tick. Like, you're not doing parentheses or anything, you just put it right there. And that will invoke the function in a special way. So it will call the function with an array called literal, and we just called it literal string. And then this is probably some syntax not all of you are familiar with. Anybody know what this is in an arguments list? We're going to look into this a little bit later. It's called rest parameters. But basically, you could think of it like this: interpolation 1, interpolation 2, interpolation 3, 4, and so on and so on, and then putting all those things into an array. That's what it's doing. We'll look at that a little bit more later. Yes, so the spread operator is actually used on the other side of function. So like when you call a function using this dot dot dot, that's when you're using the spread operator. On the argument side, the receiving side, it's called the rest params, or it's called rest params, the rest params operator, yeah, something like that. Thank you, and we will be talking about that too. Okay, great. So anyway, you can like investigate this and what I'm doing in here to your heart's content, but it's just know that you can tag template literals by adding just a tagging function right in front of it, and that function accepts things in a special way, and explore that later because it's kind of interesting and fun. Okay, any questions before we move on to tests? How many people have already moved on to tests? Yeah. You guys are bored. Just kidding. Okay, cool. Let's go ahead and do that. So we'll pop open exercises 02 template literals.test. And inside of here, you'll find that I have 6 friends. So what I want you to do is use this person object to generate this string, and then so on and so forth for this. There is kind of an extra credit test here for the tagging. So if you want to venture, it's kind of messy. But if you have some time, you can give that a shot. And I will give you a couple minutes to do that. First person who finishes, I'll come give you a high five. First person to ask me a question also gets a high five. And until somebody asks me a question, I'm going to go ahead and do the tests right here. If you don't want to watch, you don't have to. But if you get stuck or something, maybe this will help. Yeah. Let me come right over. I'll be right there.
I should have stole some cookies and used those instead of high fives as motivation to ask questions and stuff. Oh, oh my goodness, I forgot to give you a high five. Thanks for the question. Yeah. Yeah. Anybody finished yet?
Okay, sweet. We will give you the time you need. Oh yeah, this multi-line one is kind of tricky. I'll give you a tip. You're going to start your string that is indented like this. So, just a pro tip there. How many people are to the tag test? Okay, cool. I'll give you a little bit more time to get there. Anybody finish? Okay, I'll give you another minute. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and walk through the solution, and feel free to interrupt me and ask me questions. So here we have the person friends, and in here we're interpolating the person name to get Kenzie Dodds, and getting the length of friends to get the number of friends, and then interpolating this function called to join those friends. So there's that. And then we have the multi-line strings, so just using that. I like to indent my multi-line strings because I think that it reads easier, but then you have like the indention issues. So if like this actually has semantic meaning in whatever you're making, like for example, I have this problem with markdown. In one of my projects, I'm using template literals to generate markdown. And because I like to indent things, I have to make sure that I de-indent this. So I'm using that de-indent module from NPM to basically effectively do this so that markdown is interpolated correctly. But anyway, that's the multi-line. For escaping, most things are escaped the same way. You don't have to, I should have shown this an example, but you don't have to escape single quotes or double quotes, which is kind of nice. But you do have to escape backticks, which, like, let's face it, we all do backticks in our strings, like, all the time. So, just kidding. Backticks are actually really nice from that perspective. So you have to escape less. And then for the tagging, like I said, this is pretty contrived, not super useful, but basically, we're taking the literal string at index 0, so the first literal string, which will be this section right here. And then we're adding super cool to that section. And then we have this interpolated part. So we're taking the first of our interpolated parts, that noun, and we're just sticking it right after super cool. And then right after that interpolated part, we're taking this, which is the literal string at index 1. And then after that, we're adding really here. And then we're taking this interpolated part at index 1 so that we get that. And then the rest of the string, so today question mark. So pretty contrived. If this part doesn't make sense to you, you will likely not be writing very many tagging functions for template literals, so don't worry about it as much. If you want to learn about it, then keep practicing. The MDN article is pretty good. So great. And with that, you should have all of your tests passing. If you don't, and you'd like to just make them pass and move on, then you can just copy the exercise final, paste it into your example. All of the things should pass. And if you want to, you can git commit all the things. Yeah, stuff. Doesn't really matter what it is. Great. Any questions about template literals? Are we having fun yet?
Woo!
At least learning something. Hopefully being slightly entertained one way or another. So the next thing that we're going to talk about is the new core object APIs that come from ES6. So these are actually pretty awesome, and I use these many of these things pretty regularly. Most of these things are polyfillable, and so even if you're not using Babel, you can use a polyfill to make these things work. There are a whole bunch of them, and I don't have them all in here, but yeah, just a couple of the cool ones. So here we have on the string, we now have an includes. What we used to have to do to make that work is you'd say string one dot index of world is not equal to negative 1. So I think the new version reads a lot nicer. So yeah, that's a good thing. So now you have includes, and actually one of the two features that were introduced in ES 2016 is adding includes on arrays. Yes, question.
Is there an opposite excludes?
Good question. No, there's not, but you can do that. So I wanted to point this out. ES6 has a ton of features. It was years and years since the last release of the ECmaScript standard. And lots of people were like, oh my goodness, we're going to yearly releases. I'm never going to be able to keep up. But the reason that ES6 has so many features is because it was so long since the last time we got a release of the language. This year, the release for ES2016, unfortunate naming weirdness, but ES2016's features had two features. I can tell them to you right now. One of them is array.includes, which is basically the same thing as the string version. The other one is the exponentiation operator, which basically is just shorthand for, or a syntax for math.pal. But it's like you say const foo equals 1, const var equals, well, here 1 is a bad example, 3, and then you say const, or we'll say console.log foo var. And that'll be 8. So that's 2 to the third, be 8. So, fun stuff. Two features for this year. We're okay. There are a whole bunch of other features coming down the line. Async await, I know a lot of people are really excited about that. I will be honest, I sometimes use that. I don't really use it all that much, but everybody totally loves it. So, you know, what do you do? One of my favorites is, I'm just going to continue on with some of these random ones that aren't actually standards yet, but you can now, and I think this is a stage 3 feature, but it's trailing comma on function calls and parameters lists, but you can have a trailing comma on when you're calling a function. So here I'm calling console log, I have my first argument, my second argument, then I have this dangling comma. The cool thing about that is if I wanted to add another thing, I don't have to add a comma here. And what's cool about that is get diff is nicer, because now all I have to do is add another one and another and another. I don't have to impact the line previous. So anyway, I like that a lot. There are a couple cool features coming up. Okay, so another feature that actually is in ES6 is repeat. So you can take a string and have it repeat itself several times. So if we look at this, at the output from this, on the repeat we see hello world 3 times. That's kind of handy utility, I guess. I'm pretty sure I've never used that before in production code, so what do you do? This is one that I use in production code though. Array.from, so we can finally turn, actually, anybody know that, about kind of the funny stuff with the node list? When you do document.query selector all. So when you do that, you can put in a jQuery-like selector or a CSS selector, and it'll give you all the nodes that match that selector. What you get back is a node list. It is not an array, and so it doesn't have for each on it, for example, which is much to the chagrin of many a web developer. And so with array.from, you can take anything that looks like an array and turn it into an array, which is pretty cool. A node list does look like an array. It has a length property, and it has items at index 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And so you can take a node list and turn it into an array and then call reduce and map and filter and whatever on it, which is pretty cool. And so here's just an example of that. We kind of created an array-like thing. It's an object, but it looks like an array because it has a length property. That's pretty much all that's required to make it look like an array. And then you call array.from, and we get an array out of that. Right here. Hi, and there. Array.from. You can also do array.fill. So here we're creating a new array with a length of 4. And we're filling every item with the word hey, or the string hey, starting at index 2. And so if we look at the output there, we see the first two are still undefined, but then the others are hey. So it's filled with hey, which is fun. We get object, I should say object assign is not ES6. I'm pretty sure the reason that I included this though is to show you a feature. That's not why I included it. I'm not sure why I included it, but object assign is useful, and it will be more useful when we talk about object spread in a little bit. But basically object assign makes a shallow assignment from one object to another. And so here we have object 1 is AB, A is assigned to B, C is assigned to D, and then object 2 has A assigned to Z, and then X assigned to Y. So then you call object assign, and that will assign the properties on object 2 to object 1, overriding any properties that are the same. So you can see the output here being A is assigned to Z because object 2 has A assigned to Z, and then C is D from that, and X is Y. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Any questions about the core object APIs? Okay, like I said, there are a whole bunch more that you can go look up later, but we do have some tests for some of them. So it's in exercises, new APIs.test. Anybody? Yeah, just ask me questions if you have them.
High five, yes!
I'm going to go ahead and start walking through the through the solution, and feel free to interrupt me if you have questions. So in this first one, we have a sentence, the best of times, worst of times. I'm pretty sure in the comment I didn't actually explain what you should be looking for, and so you should just, I guess, make it up. So sorry about that, should be more explicit. But here I'm assigning a result to sentence.includes, and I just use the word best because it's the best, yeah, positive words. And then, for the next one, we have this string called repeated, and we're going to assign the result to the repeated version of that and repeat it 4 times. ABC, 1, 2, 3, Michael Jackson would be proud. And then here we have an object that looks like an array, has a length property. And then we're going to assign the result of array.from. And that will create us an actual array, which is pretty handy. And then we have an array of length or yeah, an array of length 5. We're going to fill it with 3, starting at index 1, and assert that. So that's fun. Had to disable a couple ESLint or our ESLint thing because like normally you wouldn't do this. And then finally, we have this object assign. And I'm pretty sure, if I recall, there was confusion on whether object assign was included in ES6 because it was kind of a newer feature that not many people were using. And so I think the original repo that I copied this from had object assign in here. That's why I included it. But something good to know, especially when we start talking about object spread. So here we are assigning things to the target from source 1, 2, and 3. And mostly this was for you to kind of explore what things look like. And there's also like another assertion just to demonstrate that this actually isn't going to do a deep assignment, but a shallow assignment. So you can like look at that a little bit and kind of figure out how that's working. One other thing to note is even though we're assigning the result to what's coming back from object assign is actually manipulating the first object that you pass into it. And so we could just as easily, actually if we say expect result to equal target, then that will also pass. So kind of an interesting thing. Quite often you'll see, in an effort to avoid this problem, quite often you'll see an empty object as the first parameter so that you're not actually making a manipulation to that object. And now stuff is totally broken because target is now not being manipulated, which is great. Fixed. Okay, any questions? All right. Oh, you had a question? Okay. You know what? Next time I do this workshop, I think we're gonna have music going on during the exercises. Maybe that'll be fun. Gotta plan ahead better. Okay. Cool. So next thing, I'm just gonna commit the stuff.
As long as it's not Jeopardy.
Not, yeah. Yeah, I'm taking requests. Okay, cool. So our next subject is destructuring. So destructuring is, if I had to pick a favorite feature of ES6, I wouldn't because I can't, but I really like destructuring a lot. So destructuring, actually, if you kind of peruse the ES6 code and then the transpiled equivalent, then you can kind of see where the value of destructuring comes. It makes things more terse and declarative, which is great. So here we're creating or making a const declaration. Okay, before I go on too far, you may run into syntax that you're not familiar with in the future. And this is how you, how do you Google syntax, right? Like that's hard to Google syntax. And so you need to find what the name of this thing you're not familiar with is. Sorry, I'm like totally, this is total tangent to what we're talking about. So there's this really cool tool called AST Explorer. So it's astexplorer.net. And it allows you to explore the AST of the code. How many people are familiar with AST? Okay, it's not really a super common thing for the application developer to use or know about. But basically, it is a object representation of your code. And so things get names and stuff. So I'm going to take this code, I'm going to paste it into the AST Explorer, and you're going to see a tree on the right-hand side. And what's cool is I can click around, I'll click right here, and it will update the part of the AST that represents that code. So I can jump around and it'll take me to all those places. So if you see it, something like this and you're like, what on earth is that? Never fear, you can use the, this tool to find out what it's called and then go look up stuff on it. So I highlight that, I see it's an array pattern. If I look at that, it's actually just part of a variable declarator, which is part of a variable declaration. The variable declaration being the entire thing here. So if I hover over this, you'll see that it's highlighting it in yellow right there. So this whole line is a variable declaration,
and it has a declarations as an array. One of those declarations is a variable declarator, and that has an ID being an array pattern. So normally you'll find that IDs are identifiers. So this is the identifier for this variable declarator. But in our case, this is an array pattern that has elements, and each one of those have identifiers and so on and so forth, like a bunch of words. Anyway, the whole reason that I wanted to show you this is so that when you come across some syntax that you're not familiar with, you can copy it, paste it into astexplorer.net, and find out what it's called, and then Google that. So hopefully that's helpful to you in the future. It's been helpful to me. I learned what an import specifier was that way. Fun stuff. Okay, back to destructuring. Sorry to take that quick detour. So, yeah, so this is an array pattern. I actually didn't know that's what this was called, so I just learned something new here too. So here we are making a variable declaration, and we're pulling out A and B. We're creating two variables called A and B, and pulling out the first, oops, let me just zoom in here a little bit, the first, and we're skipping the second, and then the third items. So we're assigning the first item of 1 to A, and then the third item of 3 to B. So if we console log those, we'll see 1 and 3. And if you see the transpiled code, it's going to create a variable. We don't care what it's called. It just tracks all that for us. It's going to call it ref, and then it's going to pull off the item at index 0 and index 2. So just some magic to make it work in older browsers and older environments. But that's basically all that destructuring is. Yeah. Oh, if I do that? Oh, and take that away? Yeah, so now B is going to be assigned to the second one. Yep. Nope. It and in fact, you can do this. You can also do, now A is being assigned to the third one. So, yeah. So, fun stuff. I really, really, really like destructuring. I don't use it on arrays quite as much. I will use it sometimes when you do like a regex match or something to get groups off of the regex match, which is pretty handy. It's pretty cool. So yeah, then you can do the same thing with objects. Instead of these, the braces here you use, or instead of the brackets you use braces. So here we have this animal. The name is Keela, the type is dog, and we can pull those things off of the animal object. Pretty handy. And then we can actually alias these names. So with an array, it's kind of cool because you can, like, it's all just positional, right? That's arrays are positional. So you can call this A and B, whatever you want. But if you're destructuring things off of an object, you have to specify what property of that object you're trying to get. And then there are some scenarios where you want to name that property something different. And so you can alias those things by adding a colon and then what the alias you want it to be is, which is pretty handy. So here we have custom name and custom type, whatever you want to call it. That can be whatever you want. Yeah, does that bit make sense? Okay. Sweet. You can also use it in arguments in your functions. So here we're going to, if we look at how it's being invoked, we're calling it with an object. And then here we have this drawSquare function that is destructuring the object. And so like the alternative way to write this, if we look at the transpiled version, is you accept a parameter name, just a normal parameter name, and then you pull off the things off of that you want. So you can do that whole step in one line by just doing this destructuring syntax. And you can do the aliasing things that you want or whatever you want. It all just kind of works right there. Yeah?
Can you use this for default function?
Yes, you can, and we will talk about that soon, hopefully. Sweet. Let's see. Oh, yeah. Here's one handy thing about destructuring. This is a good thing. So it fails softly I think this is a good thing. Lots of times I like it when things fail hard, but this is one case where I'm glad it fails soft. So if we have an array of no items and try to destructure the first item off of it, then that's just going to give us undefined. And this would be the same kind of scenario if we say first equals, here, we'll say this is array, and then array at 0, right? Like, it's going to be undefined. We're not going to get an error for that. So that's part of the reason why I think that's good. And then also defaults, and yeah, we're going to talk more about defaults in parameter lists, but in destructuring, you can actually say, hey, if there is not a first, then I want the first variable that I'm creating to be assigned to 1. And so that's pretty handy. So now first is going to be equal to 1. Special fun syntax. Very declarative, awesome stuff. So the way that it actually, just to, for a little closure on that, we're going to create a new array, and then we're going to get an item off of that array, and then we're going to assign our first value to whether that thing is undefined, or if it's undefined, then we're going to assign it to the default of 1 that we said, or we're going to assign it to the value that it actually is. So, cool. Everybody ready for the exercises? All right, sweet. So let's go ahead and pop open in exercises, destructure.test.js, and yeah, start destructuring. Oh, sorry. Oh, you know what? Last time I gave this workshop, I forgot to talk about that too. I should write a note to myself to do that. Somebody tweet at me to remind me to do that. But let's talk about nested destructuring. So here, where is it? Is it this one? Yeah. No. Which one? Below. Latin long. Okay. So let me do this in here, and then you can do it in the test yourself. So if I had, well, yeah. Let's say I've got this object, foo object that has, I don't know, a name, and a first is Nancy, and a last is Doe. So if I wanted to get the first and last properties off of those, then I would say const name, whoop, okay, thank you, and then first, last equals foo. And I think I just, first is read only. Oh, right, because all that stuff. There we go. So, it's kind of funny looking syntax, and I honestly, I would probably never really go deeper than one level of destructuring here. What I might do instead is I'd say name equals foo, and then I destructure first and last off of name. Which is effectively the same thing, but yeah, that's how you do deep destructuring, is you say, okay, I'm going to destructure this thing, but actually not really, I'm going to destructure these things off of it instead. Same thing goes for arrays, so we have 1, 2, and then a nested array of 3 and 4, and then a further nested array of 5 and 6. I'm pretty sure this is almost exactly like the example that we're going to be doing. Then you can get that by saying, okay, 1, and then we'll skip 2, and then we'll nest and go to 3, skip 4, and we'll nest and skip 5 and go to 6, equals 5. So, yeah, fun and declarative, right? Yeah, don't do this. Nobody can read that. But yeah, you don't often have to do that kind of nested destructuring anyway. But I would just assign the pieces out as variables, and then it's like destructuring is a lot easier that way. So, anybody have any other questions? Okay, I think I'll give us like 5 more minutes or something. Maybe like 2 more minutes. Anybody finished already? Okay, we have a couple. Okay, I think we'll go through the solution now. Oops. Okay, so this is what we did. So this get address function, we just look at that for a second. It returns us an object that has a state, or a city, state, zip, and coordinates object. We also have a get numbers function that returns us an array of numbers 1 through 6, and then a get nested numbers that does a bunch of weird nesting and stuff that like you probably don't see very often in your day-to-day development. And so here we're going to pull off city, state, and zip from get address with this destructuring syntax. And then in here, this one's just to demonstrate that like if you try to pull off a property that isn't on that object, you're going to get undefined. So you can have this be like foo, like it doesn't matter really that it's address or whatever it is. And then here we're going to alias things. So we have get address, we're going to pull off city, state, and zip and alias them to C, S, and Z with this special syntax here. And then we're going to also do the deep destructuring, nested destructuring that we were talking about. So we're going to get the chords object and destructure that into lat and long. And we could destructure this further. If lat was an object, we could destructure that even further. And then we can also do defaults and all that fun stuff. And then on the array side of things, we're going to get numbers and pull the first two items off of it, 1 and 2. And we're going to skip 2 to get 3. And then we're going to do this nested garbage that, like, I only do this so that you can see and never do it again. Because, like, who can read that? I can't read that. Cool. Any questions about destructuring? One of my favorite features of ES6. Okay, great. So I'm going to commit this. More foo. I'm not going to push this, by the way. Probably should be on a branch, just in case. Okay. Now, we'll move on to modules. So, modules, ES6 modules are awesome, fantastic, and there's a lot about them. I actually have an entire talk that's an hour long about ES6 modules. So it's called More Than You Want to Know About ES6 Modules. So, and yeah, in here we have this special syntax to import and export modules. So unfortunately, the Babel REPL online isn't capable of like doing anything meaningful with modules, actually importing or exporting files or anything like that. And so you'll just get exports that's not supported in the browser. But it does actually transpile it down to common JS if you're familiar with Node module syntax, so you can look at that. And actually, this link will take you to my talk repo, where you'll see like what the output would look like and stuff. And I have slides that are really similar to this that show you what the output looks like and stuff. So if you want to learn more about it. But basically, we have a couple ways we can import things. So if math is a module that exports a whole bunch of functions on it, then we can get all those functions by saying import everything as math. And then now math is an object that has all of those things that are exported. You can import very specific things, so we're going to import pi from math, and now we have this pi variable that we can use. I'm not sure why I don't have an example in here, but you can actually alias this as well. So just like with destructuring, we saw that like sometimes you need to change the name of things that you're destructuring because you have like variable conflicts or something. You can have the same scenario here. And you might think that how you do it is with a colon, but that's not. So don't let it fool you. It fooled me, and it's embarrassing, but this is not destructuring. What we're doing here is a totally separate thing, even though it kind of looks like destructuring. And so to alias things, you use the as keyword inside of here. So we're going to say import specifier pi as capital pi, whatever you want to call it. So that's how you alias. Here we have, we can import a default export. So most modules, you're either going to do a default export, and that's what you favor. But for utility modules and stuff, doing named exports is actually really nice. So this math module presumably is exporting a bunch of named exports, a bunch of functions or whatever. And then this sum module is exporting like a function or an object or something as a default export. And so then we can just pull that off. And we can call it whatever we want. Don't need to alias it or anything like that. Just as a tip, if this lib math module was doing both named exports and default exports, then this math object that we're getting by saying import star math as math, it will have a default property, and that's where we can get the default export. Okay, so on the export side of things, you can export everything, like all the named exports from a module. So you can say, hey, I am this module, and I want to take all that module stuff, and I want to export that myself. So I just forward on the export. You don't do that a whole lot, but sometimes you can have like a directory that, or a file in a directory. Oh, whoops, I just spilled like a bunch of stuff. That just happened. During the next break, I'll clean that up. So you could have like a file that's responsible for taking all of the modules inside of that directory and forwarding it on, and so people can just like import that file and get all the stuff they need from that. That's one scenario that could be useful. You can also export, this is a named export, so you can say, hey, I want to take the add function and I'm going to export it, and so people can import add with the curly braces, similar to how we're importing pi. And then you can also export, have a default export. So here we have a calculate function, so people can import it like this. There are a couple other ways that you can use ES6 modules. We're not going to get too far into them. Yeah, that's that. So I'm going to let you jump into the exercises. It's exercise 05. And one other important thing about ES6 modules is you have to write them at the root level of the file. So you can't put imports inside of callback functions or functions at all. They have to be at the root level. That comes with some limitations, but it also, limitations can sometimes be freeing. There are other ways to dynamically get modules in the ES6 world, but we're not gonna get too far into that. One other thing, so here on this last test where you can import from node modules, the only reason that actually works is because Babel is transpiling our import statements to common.js, and so like node, thank you, that was nice of you, expect a high five in a sec. Because Babel is transpiling it down to common.js, the node takes over and can get stuff out of node modules. So there's nothing special about the ES6 module specification about node modules or anything like that. That's still being worked out. In fact, there's no environment today that can actually load these modules. So they may be able to parse the syntax, but you can't actually use this in the browser yet, which is kind of too bad. You use it with Babel and transpile it, and then use Webpack, and poof, everything works great. So, okay. Any questions, feel free to ask at any time. Yeah. Yeah, good question. So yes and no. It does work if you're using Babel to transpile from imports to common.js. And then once you're in a common.js environment, like everything just kind of works. But you have to be aware of some interesting things. So if you want to learn more about this, go to kcd.im/tiers. That is a blog post that I wrote to describe some of the pain that I experienced when trying to mix these things. So, especially when Babel 6 broke the bug that I was depending on. So, progress is good. Yes. Yeah, good question about TypeScript versus Babel. So TypeScript and Babel can both transpile ES6 to what you can run today. TypeScript on top of that has this ability to do type checking. Babel can also do that type checking with Flow. Babel doesn't actually do the type checking in that scenario. Flow is doing the type checking, and then you just have a Babel plugin that wipes out all the type annotations. And then from there on, it's all just ES6 now. So a couple of the differences, TypeScript is kind of takes kind of control over the whole environment, all of your code at that point, and just kind of like you're using TypeScript for type checking as well as transpiling. You can tell TypeScript to output ES6 code and then transpile that with Babel. So yeah, like you can kind of mix and match these tools a little bit. My own perspective, I prefer Babel. And if I wanted types, then I would use Flow. The reason for that is Babel is always like much more ahead as far as implementing upcoming features than TypeScript is. I actually, anybody here ever listened to JavaScript Air before or heard of JavaScript Air? Yeah, awesome. JavaScript Air is a podcast that I run called that's just about JavaScript as a web platform. And I recently had the author of TypeScript and the author of Flow on the show to talk about type JavaScript. Yeah, it was fantastic. So you should go check it out, javascriptair.com, to learn more about this. On the show, though, I kind of explained why I prefer Babel. And it's, yeah, it's because I have access to the newer features sooner. What is his name? The guy who created TypeScript. I feel kind of embarrassed that I don't know his name. Anders, that's right. So Anders said that they will always stay on top of stage 4, which is like, this is definitely making it into the language, just wait till the next release. Whereas Babel is normally has everything implemented from stage 0. Normally that's not a problem unless the feature requires parser changes, so it's like a special new syntax or something, in which case TypeScript wouldn't be able to consume that special new syntax. And then also, Babel has a plugin ecosystem where TypeScript doesn't. So if you wanted to add your own custom transform for your code or something, you couldn't do that with TypeScript, and you can do that with Babel. And that's one thing that I've like really jumped into with Babel is I do a lot, like I use a lot of custom plugins and stuff, and I totally love it, and it's awesome.
The reason I'm asking is because I'm a little too sensitive for that mostly. I'm TypeScript.
Yeah, yeah. Angular 2 is definitely a TypeScript thing. Like, if I were doing Angular 2, I would be kind of silly to not use TypeScript. But I'm not. I'm doing React, and I love it. Yeah. Congratulations to Angular 2, by the way. They just released officially yesterday.
Oh, they did?
Yeah. Woohoo! Good for them. They're 3 days short of 2 years working on it. So that's exciting. I don't think I've ever worked on something for 2 years before it was released. Yeah, good question. Mm-hmm. Yeah, good question. So if you're on Node 6, then you get like 99% of ES6, which is pretty cool. So the one major thing that you don't get is these modules. They're working on that right now, trying to figure out how these modules will behave in the Node ecosystem, because right now with CommonJS, there's a lot to do with like Node modules directory and index.js file and special handling if you have a package.json in the folder and stuff like that. So they have to kind of work that out, and like the major challenge is detecting whether a module is exposing itself as an ES6 module or a CommonJS module. That's a difficult thing to do, and then interop between the two. So yeah, they're working on that bit right now, but if you're using Node 6, you have pretty much all the rest of ES6 to play around with. For my stuff, I still use Babel in those cases because I like using features that aren't yet released. So I'm not like that far on the side of you know, iffy features. I don't use stage 0 features or even stage 2 features that I think are kind of like, I don't know about this one. But like stuff like the object spread, async await, that kind of stuff, I'll use, and I love it, and it's great. And also the tailing comma on function calls and params, I like doing that stuff too. But yeah, if you're in Node 6 and you're okay just using ES6 stuff, then yeah, you don't need to worry about it. And that's actually one of the cool things about doing Electron is because like also you have the latest version of Chrome in there as well, which has everything except modules pretty much as well. And so you can do Electron apps and just be like rocking it with ES6 without any tooling of any kind, which is pretty cool. The ES6 module, so the import syntax here, you have to use comma.js. Yeah, so the question is, do I see a future where JavaScript is strongly typed and you're required to type them? I don't think that'll ever happen, personally. There are too many, I don't know, like even if there was, like that was technically like feasible, I'm sure it's technically feasible, but there would be too many dissenting opinions on that for a proposal like that to make it through the TC39. So it's for political reasons and also potentially even like really valid reasons, I don't think that'll ever happen. But I'm of the opinion that I'm going to be transpiling forever. I'm always going to have tooling between me and the browser. And in fact, even if you're not using ES6, you do have tooling between you and the browser. Or you should, because you should be uglifying your code before you send it to production, right? Unless you're just on Node. But if you're doing anything with the browser, you should be minifying and uglifying your code. That's tooling, so just stick another thing in there. Transpile it too. So I'm going to be transpiling forever. And I love it. It's awesome. Cool. Any other questions, or should I just run into the solution here? Maybe I'll do that. Whoops. Okay, so 05 modules. So magic. So here we have we kind of did this one for you already, but Mathy, or actually let's look at the Mathy module. So here it's doing a named export of square root, square, and diag. And those are all just utility functions. And so we're going to import all of these as an object, and we're going to call that object Mathy. And then we're going to just assert that those things exist. And then we can, I should change this word. It is, we are not destructuring the import. We are specifying what we're importing. But we can also alias those things as well. So here we're going to import square root as my square root and square as my square. And then those are actually equal to Mathy. So it's the exact same thing, referencing the same variable. And then we can also, because we're transpiling down to comma.js, we can import underscore from Lodash, and that works as well. So that's that. Any questions or comments or thoughts or celebrations? Okay, so we have just about a half hour. So I knew this was going to happen. So I'm going to now let you all have the choice of what we cover. We're going to be a little bit more selective and we can skip over things. So that was modules. Object literals are awesome. We also can talk about parameters, rest and spread, arrow functions, classes, sets, maps, weak maps, and weak sets as well. So with all of that in mind, we actually also, if you look at the exercises, we go beyond that into promises, generator symbols, and async await. I'll tell you right now, some of you might be like, ooh, generators sound like fun. You will really not use them very often unless you're using a library that requires you to use them. I have used them zero times in production. They sound like a lot of fun, but they're pretty complicated, and I don't really think they're quite as valuable. Some people really, really like them, but I don't know. Anyway, with all that said, I'm going to go by majority vote on these. So how many people want... we do have a half hour, so we could probably cover like three more things. How many people want to talk about object literals, like enhanced object literals? Okay. Cool. So parameters? Okay. People just don't want to talk about stuff. Rest and spread. Okay, arrow functions. All right. I'm just gonna go with like the most people voting for things. Classes. Y'all in your classes. Just kidding. Sets. Okay, and maps. Okay, and weak maps. All right. So some of y'all don't like voting, but I think it's pretty fair to say that we don't need to dive into many of these things. So I think I will leave the tests up to you to go implement later if you're interested, and I will just quickly talk about the features, and then we'll go into tests for the things that you want to go deeper on. So object literals have been enhanced in several ways with ES6. So now you can assign the prototype at creation time, which is pretty cool. So here we have just a regular object we are assigning as the prototype. We could add functions and whatever we want. Prototype is a word that I never type in JavaScript. So if you're typing prototype, good on you. You probably will love this. But yeah, I never type the word prototype in my JavaScript. I just don't use that kind of semantic stuff. Also, this is pretty cool. So we have this function called handler, and we're going to assign a property on our object called handler. So this is what we would do in ES5. We'd say handler is assigned to handler, and I like typing the same thing over and over again. No, I don't, and so now I really don't have to, and it's awesome. So it's just shorthand. Also, functions. So here we have this toString function, toString, so a function expression assigned to toString. Now you don't have to type the word function. In fact, you can get by without ever typing the word function in JavaScript now, which is kind of weird. Some people love it. I don't, but you can do that. I do like in my object literals though, I do this, unless I'm going to do like an arrow function or something like that. But yeah, normally this is what my functions look like. You just don't need a colon and the word function. That's pretty much all that does. It's pretty cool. And then computed property names. This one's pretty cool. So you put a property name inside of brackets, and you can do any JavaScript you want in there. And whatever the result of that is will be the key for that thing. And so like we can even do an immediately invoked function expression using an arrow function, which is pretty cool. So now that'll be prop 42. We can see that right there, prop 42. That's pretty awesome. And yeah, that's pretty much it. I think we didn't get enough people who were excited about this one, so we're gonna just move on. But does anybody have questions about this? Yes. Yeah, I actually use computed property names pretty frequently. I definitely don't do weird things like this. Why would you do that? But there are scenarios where you have a string or like a variable that has the property name you want, and you're going to create an object literal, and you can just stick that variable in there. So if we had, for example, const my var equals foo var or whatever, then I can just say my var is 23, whatever. And then, like, because the alternative to that is actually exactly what, well, they're kind of doing some weird things here. But the alternative would be after you create the object, then you say obj my var equals 23. And I like doing it all at once, so I do use that feature quite a bit. Yeah?
Does using Dunder Proto when you're transpiling to ES5 have any, like, weird browser issues?
I'm not sure, actually. Like, I pretty much don't know very much about prototypes. I shouldn't say it that way. I don't use them very much, and so I don't have much experience with them. But I would expect that Babel has done things to make it not be problematic, like this giant function, for example. Yeah, I'm not sure. Sorry. Other questions before we move on? Okay, I actually totally forgot I was going to give everybody like a second to stand up. Does anybody want just a quick break? We have like 20 minutes left, but okay, nobody wants a quick break. Okay, cool. So parameters, you can have default parameters and rest and spread. I use these features all the time, like almost like 60 or 70% of my functions are using one of these features. So now you can have default parameters. This is cool because like the old way that you would do this is you'd say, okay, I want y, but if y doesn't exist, I'm going to say 4 or 12, right? But then somebody passes in 0, and you're like, oh, truthy, falsy JavaScript, I hate you. So then you have to be like, okay, type of y is undefined. Then I'm going to do 12. Otherwise, I'm going to do y. And you're like, yeah, this isn't any fun. So we're just going to do this and let Babel do that for us. So that is default parameters. Pretty awesome. REST parameters are pretty cool. So here, kind of like what we were talking about a little bit before, you can have an arbitrary number of arguments that this function will accept and assign like whatever the rest of those arguments are to this array that's called y. Trying to think of anything else to say about that. If there aren't any additional parameters passed, then that array will still exist. It will just be empty. And yeah, that's pretty much it. It also like it does some funny things with arguments. Like y will not be included in arguments. It's kind of interesting. Any questions about REST params? Okay. Here's the trailing comma thing that I like. Woohoo! You can do trailing commas on function calls and parameter lists. That one's great. Yeah, and that's pretty much it for parameters. Yeah?
Can you show how to take an array and call a function that uses...
That's this one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
No, good question. We will talk about that. Other questions? Yeah.
Oh,
okay. How many people want to take time to do the test for this one? Nobody. Okay, great. Then we're not going to waste your time. You can check it out later. So then REST and spread look similar but behave a little bit differently. So here we have this spread args function that accepts three distinct parameters. And here we can take the, actually maybe a better way to show this example is like array. We'll say const array equals that. Then we're going to basically take that array and spread each item of it as the arguments to this function. Yeah. If the length doesn't match up, so if we had, like, for example, 4, then it will still be called with all 4 of them, but this one doesn't actually care about that 4th one. Alternatively, if we only have 2, then z will be undefined. So actually, if you look at the transpiled output, whoops, not that, then it's kind of, yeah, it uses apply under the hood. So if you're familiar with the function.apply, that's what it's doing. Yeah?
How close would you say this is to the kind of star operator of Python? Or something?
That's a super awesome question for somebody who knows Python. I don't. I kind of know a little bit about Python. I know that nobody has arguments about spaces or tabs in Python or where to put curly braces. That's kind of nice. But yeah. Yep. Yep. So. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so if we had 1 and 2 and then we spread those across here, then z would default to 23 because there's no item there. Also, if we had 1 and then nothing, so we had like undefined there, then we could say 42, 3 or whatever, then y would default to 43. Good question. Okay, so then you can actually, you don't just have to use this when calling functions. You can use it to concatenate arrays. And so here we have this array 1 that is 4, 5, and 6. And we're creating a new array with 1, 2, 3. And then we're spreading that other array across the rest of the items in the list. So this ultimately, Babel just transpiles this to use concat. Yeah, it's kind of a nice syntax. The alternative, like, you could think of this also as being like array 1 at 0, array 1 at 1, and so on and so forth. Right? So it's kind of nice to not have to do that. We can take arbitrary array lengths and stuff and concatenate those together. And then rest is kind of on the opposite side of things. You use this when you're destructuring. And this is actually a little bit more like rest parameters, actually. So here we have this array 2 of 7, 8, and 9. And we can destructure off the first one, like we saw before. And then we can take whatever the rest of the items in the list. So this could be 100 items long. We would get 99 items in our the rest array. So here, if we look at the output here, we see seven, and then an array that contains 8 and 9. If we were to take second here, then the rest is, even though there's only one item left, the rest is going to be an array of that one item. And then if we put in third here, the rest will still be an array. It will just be an empty array. And then here's a stage, I think this might be stage 3 by now, but a stage proposal for doing this similar thing with objects. And so you can take this exist, or we're creating a new, we have an existing object, object1, and we're creating a new one, and then we're spreading the object's properties onto that new one. And so we say, this is actually transpiling right down to object.assign. So it functions exactly the same as we saw before, where we say, okay, object 1 has properties A equals B and X is Y, and then we're creating this new object with C is D and X is Z, and because we're spreading object 1 across this new object and it's coming after these other parameters, then object 1 wins. So if there's a conflict, like in this X example, so the result of this will be X is Y. If we wanted to do this in the reverse, if we wanted to say, okay, give me all the things that object 1 has, but I'm going to override anything else, like I have the things that I want it to be, then we put that first. And then you can do the same thing with rest, where you can say, okay, give me the name property off of this, and then give me another new object that has all the other properties. And that's rest and spread with both objects and arrays. Yeah?
Can you use that to copy over arrays or objects so that you don't
manipulate them? Yeah, you can totally do it that way. Let's see, so if we wanted to just do this, we'll get rid of that. So now, this is kind of a funny way to do it, but I'm trying to think. I feel like I would do it differently, but now I can't think of what that would be. But totally works. And now the rest is a copy. You can do the same thing with objects. And this is actually one reason why I like using Babel, because this is a stage 2 proposal, all the object side of things that you can't use in TypeScript.
Does it do deep copy?
Sorry?
Does it do deep copy?
Oh, no deep copy. It's just it uses object assign, which doesn't do that. Yeah, and if you wanted something deep, you'd have to use like a library that does that. Yep, I'm pretty sure Lodash has that. Woo-hoo. Any other questions? How many people want to do the exercises for either one of these features that we talked about? Are y'all done with exercises? Yes. All right. I want some feedback at the end of this. Yeah, I want to know if the exercises, if there were problems with the exercises, or if you just prefer learning this way. So, yeah, feedback would be appreciated. Okay, cool. So, with the 10 minutes we have left, do you want to talk about arrow functions or classes? I think those are the other two. You want to talk about both of them, hopefully, quickly? Okay, I'll start with arrow functions, because I like them better than classes. Just kidding. Classes are great, and I use them actually all the time. So here we have, an arrow function. That's it. It's this funny syntax that doesn't include the word function and has a couple of interesting semantics about it. So one interesting thing is here we have this evens, and we're calling map on it to map each item in here to whatever's returned from this arrow function. So we're going to take the value from each item. So at this index, v will be 2. And we're going to say 2 plus 1. And because it's an arrow function on a single line here, we're going to have an implicit return. So if you look at the transpiled version, you're going to have a function that takes the variable v and returns v plus 1. An arrow function without curly braces will have an implicit return. Here, if you want to have multiple parameters, then you have to put parentheses around it. If you want to keep things consistent, you can actually put parentheses around all arrow functions. I don't like doing that. I think it looks funny, but some people think this looks funny. So that's JavaScript. And so here we have, we're now accepting two parameters, and we're just adding the two, like the value and the index here. And if you don't want to have any parameters, then you just do an empty thing, just like you would in a normal function. We have this implicit return of the high string. Then, if you want to return an object, so let's say, like right here, instead of high, we wanted to return name, spar, whatever. That's not going to work, because you can have braces with arrow functions. And if you think about it, what this would result in is, like if we were to turn this into function and get rid of that, now we're going to get function, curly brace, and then this, what is this even, right? So to combat that, you have to, if you wanted to do an implicit return of an object, you have to wrap it in parentheses. I do this sometimes. And let's see. Oh yeah, so to have a statement body, we're going to take this num, we're going to for each it and pass an arrow function. If you want to have multiple statements, don't use the comma operator because that's really confusing. Instead, use a block, and in here you don't have an implicit return anymore. So in our case, we don't actually care about having a return at all, so there is no return. But if you want to return something from this function, you do have to have an explicit return statement. Okay.
Why is that block not
wrapped in parentheses? Why is it? Sorry, which block?
So right there, you said the arrow function, you just go with curly braces
to be wrapped in. Oh, so in this case, sorry, let's go back here. In this case, what we're trying to do is create an object and return that. So for JavaScript to know that what we intend is to create an object rather than a block, we put it in parentheses. So the default is it will assume that it's a block, unless it's in parentheses. Here, because it's not in parentheses, because it is going to be a block. Great question. Let's see. And then one other very, very important semantic difference between normal functions and arrow functions is the this binding. How many people have spent more than 20 minutes agonizing over this in JavaScript? Yeah. So lots of your woes can go away with arrow functions. So here we have this object called Bob, and it has a couple properties here and a function. And this function is using this to get the friends. And then for each of those friends, it's going to have this arrow function. What on earth happened here? Oh, okay, that's kind of weird. Has this implicit return nonsense. Fix that. There we go. Silly me. Okay, so we have this arrow function that will actually, inside of the arrow function, uses this as well. So if we were to use just a normal function here, inside of this for each, then this will be referenced, well, because we're in ES6 land, we're in implied strict mode, and so this is going to blow up. And by this, I don't mean this, I mean this. So with arrow functions, you have what's called a lexical scope, or lexical this, which means that this arrow function actually doesn't have a this at all. You think of it more like it's a block. So it has its own closure and it's not exactly a block either, because even var declarations in here won't leak outside of it or anything. But as far as this is concerned, and super and a couple other arguments as well, as far as those things are concerned, this is just like a block, where this will reference the this inside of the enclosing closure. Arguments will also reference the arguments inside of the enclosing closure. So there are some funny things with arrow functions that you need to be aware of. Another thing that's important to know about arrow functions, like lots of people are like, arrow functions everything, it's awesome, just like never type the word function ever again. Yeah, that's okay sometimes, but you're going to wind up with a less optimal debugging experience. So let's say that you had an error that was thrown in here. In your console, you're going to get an error that says error thrown in anonymous function, which is kind of not fun. So if you don't want to have that bad experience, then you say function named thing. You give it a name, and then like whatever, convert it to a real function, whatever. The problem with that though is now you don't have the lexical this, and so you have to bind it and stuff. So all I'm saying is there are trade-offs, and don't just use arrow functions for everything willy-nilly, because sometimes you could wind up with a less optimal debugging experience. Now, in our test here, you'll see that I'm using arrow functions everywhere. Oh, spoiler alert. There we go. So I use arrow functions all over. And that's because if there's something that blows up, I don't really care what that thing's called. It's not going to really help me. My testing framework will take care of that for me. So that is arrow functions. Questions? Okay. Now classes. I know some of you are just dying to hear about classes. So I'm going to show you something in here that I hope you never do, except with like a couple of exceptions. But first, we are going to create this class called Point. And this class has a block. And this block has properties in it. So it almost looks like an object, but there's one like syntactic major difference right here, and that is you cannot have a comma because these aren't like object properties. And so one thing about classes is you can have a constructor, and so this is what's called when somebody says new point and passes in parameters. Those parameters are accepted in this constructor, and then you can assign things to the instance, so to this. And then you can reference this inside of your functions as well. And that will reference the instance that that you've created. I feel like there's, oh yeah, you can also call super. So here, well, here, let me get into that here in a second. I feel like there is something else. If you don't need to do anything in the constructor, you don't have to have a constructor. It's not required. Like a default one will be created for you behind the scenes, and you don't need to worry about it. I feel like there was something else, but it'll come up. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so you could say foo. I don't even know what the syntax is, to be honest. I think it's foo is bar. Seriously, I don't use classes for a whole lot of stuff because I don't think, I don't know. I just like objects. Just let me use my objects. So yeah, I'm pretty sure that's the syntax for it. I'm not getting any Babel errors, so I guess that's right. You can also have static properties as well. So if you wanted point.foo. I think actually it's required to have a semicolon for these things. I don't know why. I'm not a semicolon kind of guy, so that kind of bums me out. So then also actually, since you brought that up, and I want to talk about this, you can do this really cool thing with a stage 2 feature, I think stage 3 maybe, called public member properties, where I can say handle click, and this will be assigned to what looks like an arrow function. And what's cool about this is in whatever context handle click is called, it will always have this be assigned to the instance on which it's called. so you don't have to worry about this problems. And that's a really big deal in React components. And so, yeah, you get this implicit binding on the instance, which is pretty cool. I don't have anything for that in the exercise, but that's a good thing. You can extend. So this is the thing that I was saying, please don't do this, except in rare cases. So with Angular, you extend a component. With React, you extend a component to create your stuff. That is totally legit. Do that. But please don't do like 20 levels of inheritance in your code bases, because I might end up inheriting that code base one day. And I like you. I want to keep it that way. So yeah, so here you can extend and inherit behavior from parents and override that behavior. In that scenario, you'll want to call super with the necessary arguments. And then here we're overriding the toString function. But now this color point has a static foo property on it, which is pretty fun. And then we can create instances. So we create a color point. We can see the toString. And the CP is an instance of color point, and it's an instance of point because it extends it. I feel like there are a couple other things about classes that I'm missing, but that should be enough to get you going. And this is recorded. I will share the YouTube video on Slack later. So if you want to watch this again, review, then that is totally cool. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so a class, actually, if you were to like type of a class, you're going to get function. And it's a function with a like a whole bunch of prototype magic stuff to make it work. So like classes are actually implemented in all modern environments anyway, and so you don't need to like transpile it or anything. But if you do look at the transpilation stuff, they do some pretty fancy things with prototypes and stuff. Which is kind of fun. Not really, but it can be. Yeah. Or did you have another question, follow up, or did I answer that? Oh, yeah, there are no interfaces in JavaScript. Yeah. Because there wouldn't be like, there's no runtime type checking or anything to enforce that this thing actually honors the interface. So it's just like JavaScript. Looks like a duck, talks like a duck, it's a duck. So. All right. You can look at the maps and sets and promises and async await stuff later. Hopefully the repo is a pretty good resource. I think that's pretty much it. So one thing before we are done, I have in my slides, I have a couple of resources that are helpful and handy you can check out. And then here is the feedback link. Please, please, please submit feedback. Let me know what you think about the tests and whatever. It's like 2 minutes, seriously. So, yeah, I'll put that in the Slack too. That's it. Thanks.